Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. For God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. For as a father has mercy upon his children, so the Lord has mercy upon those who fear him. And as a mother comforts her child, so the Lord will comfort you. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, though they were dead, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. With these words of assurance, let us begin our worship by standing and singing hymn number 280, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. May be seated. Let us pray. Eternal God, your love for us is everlasting, and you alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. Help us then to turn to you with believing hearts, and in the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, that hearing the promises of Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the light and peace of your presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Your bulletin says that today is a service of witness to the resurrection and the celebration of life. And we have a lot to celebrate today. A life so well lived in our midst, a woman who so cared for her community and cared for her family and cared for her friends, cared for her husband, a woman who really showed us a little bit about what it means to live life and how do we love God and love neighbor. But we're also here to be witnesses to the resurrection because we believe that the promise of the gospel is that life does not end with death, that our dear sister has now just turned the cover page and begins a new life in which she is free from that which has most recently bound her, has been released into a new fellowship and a time of great joy in which she reunites with her dear husband and celebrates all of what is good about life. But in the midst of that, we feel our sorrow, we feel that absence, we wish she were here longer, and we give thanks and at the same time express our sorrow for the fact that she is no longer with us. And so as we reflect upon the resurrection to eternal life, we hear the words of Scripture, and we also remember some of the things that were very important to Sandy and very important to many of us, especially in her life with the Girl Scouts. So I would like to invite her grandchildren to come up. We're going to put all of those lessons together, and they are going to share with us both readings from Scripture as well as some Girl Scout messages.
Hi, I'm Brady Foster, grandson of Sandra Stewart, and I'm going to be reading John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? Thanks.
Hi, my name is Jameson Stewart, grandson of Sandy Stewart. And today I'll be reading from Revelations. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
Hi, I am Reese Foster, granddaughter of Grammy Stewart. Today I'm going to be reading a poem, And the Promise, by the Girl Scouts. Because of you, she makes a promise and keeps it. Because of you, she learns a lot and lives it. Because of you, she goes into the world and changes it. Because of you, the Girl Scout volunteer. If any Girl Scouts out there would like to join in with the promise, you can hold up the sign. On my honor, I will try to serve God and my country, to help people at all times, and to live by the Girl Scout law. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Maddie Stewart, and in honor of my Grammy's time with the Girl Scouts, I will say the Girl Scouts law. I will do my best to be honest and fair, friendly and helpful, considerate and caring, courageous and strong, and responsible for what I say and do, and to respect myself and others, respect authority, use resources wisely, make the world a better place, and to be a Girl Scout to every sister.
Well done, you guys. I'd like to invite one of Sandy's pastors to come forward to share a little bit of a pastoral reflection and to share a bit of their great friendship, Dr. Maggie Brown.
I would like to celebrate the life of Sandy Stewart this morning by sharing a few stories of Sandy, the church lady who loved God and loved a neighbor. When we first arrived in Sarasota almost 11 years ago, my husband Will and I met Sandy and Dawn at a dinner at the Kavanaugh's house. Dawn explained to us about his heart. Sandy was proud and happy to explain to us in great detail with her parts in Dawn's life. She loved her husband, Dawn, so very much. And Sandy said that Dawn's heart troubles brought them back to God and to church. how she told us how God has been blessing them, the prayers and care from the church were lifesavers for both of them, that she's always going to serve God by staying involved in the church's life. Sandy did just that all the way to the end. She did not even miss one Sunday. The last Sunday she was sitting right there. Sandy loved God. Oh, before that, she also told me when we first met that I'm going to talk to you every Sunday under the big old tree until you remember who I am. And you all can hear that, right? And then she said, you will have no problem recognizing Don. He's the only guy with a black purse in this church. Sandy loved God and loved her church. Sandy loved worshiping with Don on Sunday mornings. They sat way over there every Sunday. She loved being with her children and grandchildren and was happiest when she saw her grandchildren in church. She loved being an elder in the church and serving on committees like administration and finance, where she could use her professional experience and skills. For some years, her favorite thing to tell me was, I'm the oldest on ANF committee. She was very proud of that, and that tickled her soul. She loved talking to everyone. Dawn often waited patiently after church for her. She loved her intellectual challenge on Wednesday night lectures by her favorite pastor, Steve. And she loved to participate in discussions on those lectures. She loved being an elder, as I mentioned before. She loved serving communion in the church. The second last time I saw Sandy, it was at Bay Village. We were serving communion, home communion together. I was going around carrying her coffee cup that was full and hot, and she carried my communion elements. And then she told me, before we enter everyone's apartment, she said, you do the liturgy, I am the elder, I get to serve the communion. So that short lecture lasted to every stop we made. We had a blast. We talked, she really, really wanted to go live at Bay Village, and I'm so thankful to God that she got to do it, and she enjoyed that very much. Like I said before, Sandy always loved talking with people everywhere she was, a cup of coffee under that big old tree, and talking with people and listening and learning about their happenings in lives. And of course, Don was always waiting patiently. He loved his wife very much. How do you talk about one without the other? Sandy loved to be the head of tables of six or eight dinner fellowship. Sometimes her group got into being 11 in the name of tables of six. Sandy was loving, kind, hospitable, honest, and direct in speech. Once I said to her, you are from the deep south. Aren't you supposed to be sweet and tactful? And she said back to me, you're an Asian. Aren't you supposed to be quiet and demure? So we both laughed, and I give thanks to God for my friend Sandy, who loved God and who loved all of us.
I'd like to invite Greg, Sandy's son. Hard act to follow there, Greg, but come on up and...
So, Mimi, thank you. That was wonderful, a wonderful tribute. And when I look out there, thank everyone for coming today. You know, that this was special to my sister and myself to see all the faces out there, friends, colleagues, neighbors that have all come out to join us to pay respects to my mom today. So we really appreciate it. And I know tonight, when you look up at the sky, one of the stars will be shining just a bit brighter. So one of the things I noticed over the last couple of weeks is that lots of little things really make you remember the good times you had with your mom. So just yesterday, and Allison, you can't cry. So just yesterday, I was on my phone, which my kids will make fun of me for, and a Facebook post came up, and almost 5 years ago to the day, we had a celebration of my parents' 50th anniversary. She was actually would have been 55 years on August 10th. So they had a long, long life together. But for that night, we had a really special celebration where many of you were there. It was a fun night. We shared lots of stories, lots of laughter. My sister did a short 30-minute video celebrating all of the moments of their life. And they renewed their vows because 50 years is an amazing accomplishment. But that evening, like Mimi said, one of her proudest moments was seeing her four grandkids and saying, "Can you believe how well-behaved they are?" And I thought to myself, I looked at my sister and I said, "If you only had an idea of what we had to do to make it be that good." So another thing happened this week that made me think of her. The other night was the Hall of Fame football game. Not that she was a big fan of the Hall of Fame football game, but she was a big football fan. So in honor of her love of football, I don't know if y'all can see, but I have my football socks on to help mark that moment. But I know one of the things that she loved more than anything else was her and my dad. Every Sunday, got up early in the morning, and my mom had a pool together, and they had a little friendly bet as to who could pick the most games right every Sunday. And they not only kept it every Sunday, my mom being the type A personality that she was, she had a spreadsheet, worked out, and she tracked the results for the entire season, and she could tell you how many they got right, how many they got wrong, and who was winning, both in terms of the most games and who won each week. So I know now that she's in heaven and rejoined my dad, they will be doing the pool week by week, cheering on the Bucks. They're going to need a lot of help this year. And maybe, just maybe, Alabama will make it back to the college football playoffs with one loss to the Gators, of course. So as I stopped to think about it, my mom really lived what I would consider to be an amazing life. She grew up in a very, very small town in Alabama. And her mom passed away when she was a young child. I think she was 10 years old when she passed away. So at that point in time, she had to transition from being a kid to being a mom. She helped to raise her two brothers. And later, when her dad got remarried, was part of the leadership of that family that helped raise not only the two brothers, but a stepbrother and a stepsister. But despite all those challenges, she still managed to become the first person in her family to finish college. And it's a good thing she did. Because at college, she met this sharp, funny, good-looking guy that she eventually married. And they quickly headed to Sarasota soon after my dad finished law school. And they gave birth to this handsome baby boy. Now note, Sarasota was not a place that they had deep roots in, was not a big town. When they moved here in 1970, Sarasota did not go much beyond Beneva Road. If you were beyond Beneva Road, you were out in the sticks. So they rented a tiny little apartment just over the bridge from Siesta Key, where they started the family. And they settled in together for a 54-year-old journey where my mom became a caring mother, a dedicated volunteer, a trusted leader, an elder at a church, and a loving grandparent. What was special about my mom is it really wasn't enough for her to participate. That wasn't her nature. She wanted to be involved. And that involvement often led to leadership roles in both our activities as well as her career aspirations. So when we were in school, it wasn't enough for her just to be a parent. She wanted to be on the PTA. It wasn't enough for her to be on the PTA. She had to be the president of the PTA. When we swam, it wasn't enough for her to be a part of the Sharks, a parent of the Sharks. She had to be on the board of the Sharks, and she had to be the treasurer of the Sharks. When she joined the Junior League, it wasn't just enough for her to be a member of the Junior League and a sustainer for 40 years. She was the chair of the cookbook committee, and when you guys go over to our reception today, you'll see a couple of copies out there. And just know, as you flip through that cookbook, my sister and I were guinea pigs for hundreds of those recipes. They had to suffer through sometimes multiple versions of those recipes because they may not have worked out the first time. When she started her career back after being a mom for a number of years, she started with H&R Block. And once again, it wasn't enough for her to just go to the office and be a rep for H&R Block. Soon she was managing a location, and before she knew it, she was working for a company called Arnold & Company, which got bought by Touche Ross. So before she knew it, she was working for one of the big five accounting firms. And then finally with the Girl Scouts, and Allison will get more into that story a little bit later. But at home is where mom really shined. Instilling a value system, a work ethic, and a drive to be your best that I hope my sister and I are able to pass on to our kids. And note, it wasn't just us. For any of our friends who've ever had to come to our house, you'll get the mom inquisition. How's school going? What teachers do you have? What's your major? Who are you dating? So you wanted to be a part and involved in every aspect of our life. So at the end, we learned dementia is a terrible disease. It can destroy your mind. It can limit your physical abilities. But no matter how difficult things got, one thing it couldn't do was take my mom's spirit. Right up until the very end, she was happy, often noting that she loved her place at Bay Village and loved being there. She was compassionate, and the one thing she could recite at the end of every day is all the people that she'd helped on her hall. And she was still a bit of a mom. And even in our last conversation, her questions to me were, how are Jameson and Maddie doing in school? Are they making all A's? So checking on her grandkids, which was one of the things that was most important to her. Once again, thank you all for coming out here. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Craig. Allison. Come share some thoughts about your mom.
A quote by Juliet Gordon Lowe, founder of Girl Scouts USA. You wear the badge to let people know that you are prepared and willing to be called on because you are a Girl Scout. And Girl Scouting is not just knowing, but doing. Not just doing, but being. This is how my mom lived her life. When she was part of an organization or cause, it became part of her being, and she put forth 100%, which she demonstrated with her love for the Girl Scouts. Her incredible service as a volunteer in Sarasota led her to the Girl Scouts of Gulf Coast, Florida. For a remarkable 23 years, she devoted herself to the Girl Scouts, empowering young girls to become confident leaders. Over the years, she served as the finance director for 11 years and the CEO for 12 years from 1998 to 2010. During her tenure as a CEO, she increased membership of the organization by 40% and ensured financial stability through tough economic times. She accomplished incredible milestones, leaving an indelible mark on the organization, including the groundbreaking $7.8 million capital campaign. Through her visionary leadership, two LEED certified facilities were established on the Searcy G. Cohen Regional Girl Scout Campus in Sarasota. These spaces now stand as symbols of her commitment to both the environment and the growth of the Girl Scouts. She retired on February 1st, 2010 at the age of 64. Her message when she retired, "I am honored to have positively influenced the lives of more than 100,000 girls during my Girl Scout career. I have enjoyed helping girls discover who they are and to reach their full potential to make a difference in their community." Her retirement came at a time when my dad's battle against heart disease took a huge turn. In the fall of 2009, my dad began having ongoing congestive heart failure and ended up in and out of the hospital every 4 to 6 weeks. The next 2 years led to even more trips to the hospital and discussions with multiple surgeons and medical providers about the possibility of a heart transplant or other options. On August 4th, 2011, my dad was raced once again to the hospital with congestive heart failure. This time, the doctor said he needed to move forward with the LVAD surgery because his heart was in the final months, maybe weeks, maybe days. He was sent in an ambulance to Tampa General, and the next morning on August 5th, 2011, which is today, 12 years ago today, my dad had surgery to have an LVAD installed in his chest. An LVAD is a device that is a pump attached to the heart that is used for patients who have reached end-stage heart failure. As she did with everything else in life, my mom jumped in 100% as a caretaker for my dad. She cared for him, monitored her medications, scheduled his appointments, and did every single daily dressing change out of the hospital for more than 10 and a half years. She became fully involved with Tampa General and the LVAD team. She served on the board of directors of Beat After Beat Heart Foundation, an organization that assists with the emotional and financial support to the VAD patients and their families. She and my dad loved attending medical events to demonstrate the wonderful quality of life you could have with an LVAD. My mom also returned to her full-time job of being a volunteer. She served on the board as the chair of community youth development, on the board of Samaritan, as a member of the Selby Foundation Scholarship Selection Committee, in addition to many other organizations. She was a devoted member of Church of the Palms, where she served as an elder and on many committees. Nothing made her happier than to help and support others. For example, she never said no to a Girl Scout selling cookies. If she saw 100 Girl Scouts selling cookies outside of Publix, then she bought 100 boxes. Every year, the cabinet would be full of boxes and boxes and boxes of Girl Scout cookies. Her retirement also came as she was entering a new chapter of life, and one of her favorites, being a grandmother. She retired in February 2010. Jameson was born September 2010, followed by Reese, December of 2011, then Maddie in January of 2013, and Brady in June of 2013. In less than 3 years, she became a grandmother of four. She was so proud of her grandchildren and loved the times all of us could be together. She loved going to school programs, soccer games, and hearing all about their activities. She was especially proud when Reese and Maddie both became Girl Scouts, and she was so proud and excited that she had the opportunity to take Reese shopping at the Girl Scout store. Today we celebrate the life of a woman who selflessly dedicated herself to the betterment of others, leaving behind a world that is brighter because of her contributions. Her compassionate spirit and tireless dedication to the lives of all who had the privilege of knowing her. Mom, you are a beacon of hope and inspiration to so many. You empowered young girls to dream big and to achieve their full potential as young women of courage, confidence, and character to make the world a better place. It's hard to believe that we're here again so soon after our dad's passing last April. However, having been together, as Greg mentioned, for over 55 years, when he passed, I think part of her went with him. She tried to continue all her years of service, and giving back to others. She moved to Bay Village and loved every minute being there. Even as her health started to decline, she tried to help everyone else. In her final weeks of her life, as her memory continued to decline, she spent all hours of the day asking about my dad and trying to find him. She missed him dearly, and I believe that she needed to be back with him. Yesterday, we had a beautiful ceremony at the Sarasota National Cemetery and had the opportunity to watch them place her back next to our dad. As difficult as it is today for us, we know that they are together again, doing what they love. My dad is playing tennis and swimming without the LVAD, and I bet my mom's already the chair or president of an organization in heaven. Mom, thank you for being you. It's an honor to be your daughter. You gave so much to your children, grandchildren, and everyone you touched. You modeled a life that we can only hope to follow. Thank you.
Thank you, Allison and Greg, for a wonderful way of filling out the story of your mother. It's at services like this where we get the opportunity to see all the facets of the diamond that each person is. We all saw different facets of Sandy. We all interfaced with her in a variety of organizations. We all saw her leading in all sorts of different ways, but it's always wonderful when we have the chance to kind of see what the whole diamond looks like and the many ways that she's touched so many people's lives and the many gifts that she shared in so many different ways. Perhaps it'd be best summed up with that Girl Scout law or promise: I will do my best to be honest and fair, friendly, helpful, considerate, and caring, courageous and strong, and responsible for what I say and do, and to respect myself and others, respect authority, use resources wisely, make the world a better place, and be a sister to every Girl Scout. We give thanks in a day like this when we think about people like Sandy, who just by the way she lived her life and held up to that law and promise, was one of those people that really became the glue of civilization, right? The glue of our society, the glue of this community, and seeking to support all of those institutions that were here for the betterment of the world, to make the world a better place, and to help us together to work to find ways by which we could support a variety of people, including, and perhaps most of all, our children. We here at Church of the Palms found Sandy to be one of those wonderful leaders who knew how to encourage leaders. Perhaps because she was a leader in so many different ways and so many different organizations, she understood what it meant for a leader to be encouraged. Leaders often will hear of all the things that perhaps aren't going exactly right, but Sandy was the kind of person that was there to point out all the things that were going well, all the good things that this church, and I suspect the Girl Scouts, and I suspect every other organization that she was a part of. She was the one who went around to point out all the things that were good about the organization, and that brought great encouragement to so many of us as we sought to do and live out the spirit of Sandy Stewart. And perhaps most of all, live out the spirit of Jesus, who says that the greatest of all must be the servant of all. And our dear friend knew what that meant, that in her effort to serve our community, she showed us really what is the greatest part of life, how we take care of and how we love our neighbor and how we support those that are in need of our support, including most of all her husband. Over these last 11 years or so, or 12 years, Sandy was there to do what needed to be done. She understood her most important constituencies, her children, her grandchildren, and most certainly her husband, as she cared for Don in these last several years. And always grateful that she had him for those years, given his health condition. And so we rejoice today for one who has helped us to perhaps become a better world, a better society, a better community. And we have learned a little bit about what does it mean to be a good human being. And we take from her the great lessons of life. And to quote a leader in the Scouts from long ago who said, 100 years from now, it won't matter what kind of car I drove, what kind of house I lived in, how much money I had in the bank, nor what my clothes looked like. but the world may be a little better because I was important in the life of a child. Our dear sister was important in the lives of hundreds of thousands of children, and we give thanks for how she has allowed our society to continue to flourish by her commitment to us. Praise God, from whom and to whom all blessings flow. Let us pray. O God, our Father, from whom we come and unto whom we return and in whom we live and move and have our being, we praise you for your good gift of life, for its wonder and mystery, its friendships and fellowships. We give thanks for the ties that bind us to each other and for your loving and patient dealings with us and for the meaning that lies hidden in the heart of sorrow and for your guiding hand along the way of our pilgrimage. We give thanks for this, your servant, Sandy Stewart, recalling all in her that made others love her. And we are grateful for the good and gracious influences in her home and for all who ministered to her best life. And we thank you for the goodness and truth that have passed from her life into the lives of others and have made the world richer for her presence. And we bless your name for the revelation of yourself and of your love in our Lord Jesus Christ and for the hope set before us in the gospel. And we thank you that deep in the human heart is an unquenchable trust, that life does not end with death, that the Father who made us will care for us beyond the bounds of vision, even as he cares for us here. And we praise your name for the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the source of our hope, not only today, but in all days. And we pray for the comfort of your presence and the ministry of your Holy Spirit. Renew within us the gifts of faith, patience, and enduring love. And as we step out upon the world, may we sense that though we've lost one whom we've loved, we've not lost you. And that as you have received this, your child, so too will you receive us. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us conclude our worship by standing and singing another one of Sandy's favorite hymns, hymn number 467, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
Following the benediction, I will be greeting the family and then escorting them over to the campus center, and you are invited to follow them there, and there will be a time of reception and lots of pictures of this wonderful family and the love that they share with each other, as well as all the many organizations that Sandy has supported throughout her life. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you now and forevermore, world without end and life without end.